Good evening. I'd like to call to order the August 14th, 2012, meeting of the Newmarket Planning Board. Present, we have a quorum of Ed Carmichael, our town council rep, Elizabeth Dudley, Rick McMiniman, myself, Val Shelton, and we have an alternate, Jane Ford. And at this point in time, if everyone will stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I'd also just like to have the record reflect that Janice Rosa cannot be with us this evening, nor Justin Norman. And Adam Schroeder should be joining us later. First order of business, are there any public comments relating to items that are not on the agenda? Seeing none, I'll close the public comment session. Review and approval of minutes. The first one that I'd like to add on to this is the Fox Hollow site walk of July 9th. I think everyone received a copy of that in their package. Okay. Has everyone had a chance to review that?
No, but I can
maybe take a minute.
Sure.
To review that. July 9th. Do I have a motion to approve the July 9th sidewalk Fox Hollow Drive?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the Fox Hollow Drive site review on July 9th, 2012.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And actually, before we move to the July 10th minutes, I will formally appoint Jane Ford to sit in for Janice Rosa. So you'll be voting on any matters. Mm-hmm. July 10th minutes.
Make a motion to approve the July 10th Planning Board meeting minutes of July 10th, 2012.
Second.
Any edits? I have just a couple. Page 3, the second to last paragraph, that should read stated, it is not. And Mrs. Wheeler asked why it was released. On page, did you get that?
It is not.
Do I have old minutes?
No, I think you do.
I do, sorry. You okay. Got that one? On page 6, Jeanette Hauschel.
Oh.
Read Jeanette Hauschel, not Antoinette. At the end, just to clarify that she had stated she owns property which abuts the golf course at the end of the paragraph. Okay, any other edits?
Do you want me to change my vote to add amended?
That would be great. Go ahead, Rick. So as amended, we're voting on the motion as amended.
Right.
Ed, you're good with that?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. All those opposed? Motion passes. First order of regular business is a public hearing in accordance with RSA 231-158 for tree pruning and clearing on town and Newmarket scenic roads by the Public Service of New Hampshire. This hearing is scheduled in accordance with RSA 231-158 as requested by PSNH to engage in tree pruning and cutting along Bay Road in the town of Newmarket. The proposed activity will include but not be limited to tree cutting, trimming, and removal of brush and trees. All proposed activity and criteria for action by the applicants will be presented and reviewed at this public hearing. Is the applicant here? Any representative from the applicant? None. Okay, discussion by the board. Diane was kind enough to forward us the minutes of the prior meeting, which permission was granted May 20th, 2008. Relative to the RSA, before any cutting gets done on a scenic road by the municipality or utility, they have to come before the planning board for a hearing. On the 2008 meeting minutes, I'll just point out that motion was approved for a trimming of trees along Bay Road by PSNH and the contractors with conditions. And there were four conditions here. The town of Newmarket's interest in wood chips they've made available to the public. That the trim clearances for the trees be cut by half of what is shown within the pamphlets that they provide at the time. And that photographic evidence and identification of the proposed 16 trees to be provided to the town planner. And that the frequency of trimming be increased to every 2 years instead of every 4 years. I'm assuming that they're back to us. They did not do the two-year cutting. They have identified, I believe, six trees that they want to remove in their application. So, are there any members of the public that are here to speak on this? None. Go ahead.
So my understanding, if there's a particularly valuable tree, that is going to be that's why trees are reviewed with Diane to make sure there isn't a spectacular tree that is removed. Is that sort of the justification for looking at?
It's not only pertaining to tree clearing, but any maintenance within the stone walls to protect the scenic qualities, if you will, of the road.
So they have a right to move stone walls as well as trees?
No.
That's another provision in the state law where a public hearing has to be held.
They're clearing
it's
below
not just
the power
for tree
line.
Clearing.
Oh, it's not just for tree clearing.
But
right.
This is for trimming.
Okay.
This particular application
okay.
is for trimming. Sorry, I didn't mean to confuse the issue.
Okay, I think I understand about the stone walls, but it's a separate.
Yeah, and they're referring to six trees because of the condition of the tree to remove.
Okay.
In 2008, they removed 16 trees.
Okay.
Now they're requesting an additional six trees. We do have a tree warden now in town, so I don't know if they need to review any of this.
So are these aren't mapped, so we see where these poles correspond to.
Yeah, they are mapped. If you go down Bay Road, you can find each pole, and it will
okay, but I mean not here for
no.
us.
No, you'd have to go down Bay Road and look between these poles, and you can see the tree.
So these are caliper trees, so it looks like there's a 34-inch caliper tree that is... So I guess we just have to trust that no majestic trees of note would be moved unless it was absolutely necessary. Is that where we're coming from?
It's just trimming.
Well, these trees they're requesting to remove because there's a 34-inch that is declining. Because of hollow tree poles. There's an 8-inch dead vine covered locust.
Hollow tree poles? I mean, it has a hollow center.
Right.
Yeah.
There's a rotted base in a partially dead crown on a 30-inch ash. Mm-hmm. There's an 8-inch dead tree. There's a 12-inch declining maple. And it's 24-inch ash with a decay column at the base.
Since I know little about this, I'm just asking, if this is on a private property, is the owner of the property notified if is to be removed?
The property is actually owned by the landowner.
Bay
Road's not a dedicated road to the town. It's so they own to the middle of the road.
Okay.
So any tree removal, they need to get permission from the also from the landowner.
So that in addition to our permission.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, well that simplifies things from my point of view.
It appears that they're not exactly healthy trees.
Okay.
The materials that have been provided to us. And they are hazardous and interfere with the public service lines.
Will they remove the, any trees they cut down, will they remove the base?
Grind the stump, you mean?
Stump.
They specifically state...
Because the last time, I know that was mentioned, and it was in prior years before 2008, it said that they hadn't been done.
They called for the removal of brush, which is less than 6 inches in diameter at the ground level, and limbs which are located within 8 feet to the side, 10 feet below, or 15 feet above the conductors. So, in the 2008 approval, conditional approval, we had cut those in half with the idea that they would trim twice every 2 years. Whether or not that has happened, if they met those conditions, I don't know. But at this point in time, they're coming before us for this specific request. Given the frequency of power outages and impact to these power lines along Bay Road, I recall when we heard it from the last time, there is the financial issue of coming out every 2 years to do minimal trimming, as opposed to coming out every 4 years, trimming everything back away from the power lines for the purpose of maintaining, you know, electrical power along Bay Road.
So the dead tree, they're just going to cut in half?
So to specifically answer your question, they state here, all brush and limbs cut on the roadside locations will be chipped. In wood and undeveloped locations, the chips will be dispersed into the woods, taking care not to allow chips to accumulate in piles or in ditches. Near developed land, the chips will be blown into a truck and disposed of off-site. We could also, as we did last time, request the chips to be given to the town.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We have here. Brush and limbs cut on inaccessible lines will be stacked to the side of the right-of-way and cut low to the ground. All will be left on site unless otherwise directed by the landowner. So if they're doing any cutting in front of the particular lot, those people will leave them on site unless the landowner says remove it.
Okay. So they'll leave stumps if there's...
Well, yeah, they're not taking stumps out.
I guess that was my question. Because they're taking down the 3-8-inch dead tree.
So do you have a concern about that the road agent should, if there's a stump left, that it's not a hazard? I don't know where you're going
well,
with it, Rick.
If it's not a hazard, then I thought I saw in the 2008 I was reading, there was a question raised about a stump that hadn't been taken out, that should have been taken out, but I can't find it, so.
Yeah, it wasn't noted in the conditions.
Are you worried about it being unsightly visually since it's a scenic road? Is that
your
concern?
Have you been down Bay Road lately? You're lucky to see the side of the pavement.
Sounds good. I have no major problem with asking the question.
What is the pleasure of the board as far as addressing this?
It seems to me that if people use the chips, it makes good sense, as you suggested, to request the town have them for dispersal to interested residents. Otherwise, I would say I have no qualms with anything else. I don't know, or anything, really. Mm-hmm.
Diane, was it helpful to have the photographic evidence for the file? Did you get it?
I don't think we ever got it.
Okay.
We could ask for that again.
Okay. And Rick, are you looking for any condition on stumps?
No, that's okay.
So I'll entertain a motion.
Make a motion to approve the trimming of trees along Bay Road by PS&H and our contractors with the following conditions. One, that the town of Newmarket is interested in the wood chips and that they be made available to the public. Two, that the trim clearances for the trees can be cut in half by half of what is shown within the pamphlets. That the photographic evidence and identification for the purposes of the trees be provided to the town planner. And last, the frequency of trimming be increased to every 2 years instead of every 4 years.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second that.
Okay. Would you entertain a friendly amendment that the clearances
Absolutely.
The clearances be as requested?
I would recommend that.
And that the trimming frequency be every 4 years?
Do you want to change it to 4 years? Sure. Yeah.
I just think instead of having planning board actions that aren't, you know, I don't, they basically would be in violation.
I'll accept the amendment.
And what we're doing, not having them clear the trees.
Mm-hmm.
Jane, are you good with that?
I'm good.
Okay. So does everyone understand the motion? It has two conditions. The town can get the wood chips if they want them, and the PSNH will provide photographic evidence of the 6 trees to be removed. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries. The next item on the agenda, Town of Newmarket, William Morgan, Angel View Pet Cemetery and Crematory, Site Plan Review and Conditional Use Permit at 426 Wadley Falls Road, Tax Map R6, Lot 52-1B3 Zone. The proposal is for an animal crematorium to provide crematorium services for equines and large companion pets. So can we clarify this? This is not... Oh, that's the name of the company is
correct.
William Morgan Angel View Pet Cemetery and Crematorium.
That's correct.
Okay. Can you state your name?
Sure.
For the record.
My name is FX Bruton. I'm with Bruton and Barraby, a law firm in Dover, New Hampshire. And I represent the applicant. Bill Morgan is here tonight. And the project engineer, Joe Parashino, is here from Ty & Bond. And let me start with the name. I'm sorry. Angel View Pet Crematoria or Cemetery and Crematoria represents a crematoria and pet cemetery in Massachusetts.
Can you hear better
you
in the back of the room?
Why don't you move forward?
I'm sorry.
Maybe the mic isn't on.
How about I'll go like this. Is that a little bit better?
Yeah. Maybe it's not plugged in.
All right.
Is the mic plugged in?
I don't think it's for their benefit anyway. I think that's just for the transmission. So in any event, the company operates a pet crematoria and cemetery in Middleborough, Massachusetts. As said in our application, which in a sense becomes a condition of this approval, there's no interest at all in creating a pet cemetery in Newmarket or at this site. So I just kind of wanted to start with that premise, that the only thing that the site, which is depicted behind me, would be doing is taking the former DPW building and using it as a pet crematoria. In doing that, or in considering that, we first came and sat with the town's planner and talked about the idea. And one of the first threshold questions to be answered was, what do we do with the fact that you're in the aquifer zone? And although we don't typically think that pet, what they call cremains, which is the remains from a crematoria, which I just learned, is solid waste. The state has identified that it is, and you can't store or handle solid waste in the aquifer zone in Newmarket. And what we did was we went through the process of getting a variance with respect to that restriction. And in fact, we did get that variance. And we went to the zoning board and we explained the process that is involved in the crematoria. And basically, the plan is a pet of either a small size or even of a large size, which could be a horse, would come to the facility and be put in the crematoria. And the ashes that you would get from that would then be stored for a short period of time. And what would happen is the ashes would then be picked up by the company and brought to their facility in Middleborough, Mass., and they would be disposed of there. So there'd be no disposal even in New Hampshire. It was kind of interesting in terms of understanding the process. Even when they do the cremation, what they do is it basically you end up with a bucket of ash, and they store it, or they put it in a box and return it to the customer. The customer could pick it up, or they could ship it, actually. And when they're done, they actually take a rag that they wipe the bucket. So there's not even any use of water, if you will, to kind of clean up the bucket and pour it down the drain. So there really is, there was no effect to the aquifer district, and that's why the ZBA granted the variance. So that was our first step. In addition, you may be aware that this site obviously was the former DPW site, and the town presented to this board a subdivision plan. And so this proposal is only to be located on that 3 acres of land, and it was, again, formerly a much larger parcel. So the applicant has a contract with the town to purchase the land, as Diane said in her memo, premised on getting approvals. And so that's why we're here. We're here for a minor site plan approval, which is the process that your site plan regulations specify. And we're also here for a conditional use permit, because this is what you might consider a flexible use, and that's permitted in the zone as long as we get a conditional use permit from you. So that we're here really for two reasons: the site plan application and the conditional use permit. So that's a little bit of the history of the project. Diane's memo to you raised some questions that we think we can answer, but also suggested that we should meet at the next meeting, which is fine with us. We do want to understand any thoughts or concerns that the board has, and see if we can address them. But generally speaking, the building, the outside of the building will not change at all. There will be some minor modifications of the interior to provide for an area, if desired by a family, where typically two or three people would come and have some form of a mini service, then receive their cremains and then leave the facility. So it's a fairly minimal use in terms of the actual property. Obviously, it's far less than what the DPW did in terms of what their use was. So the things that Joe can talk to you about now relate to some of the questions that were raised in terms of septic, parking, and ADA issues. But we think we can address all those issues now. And I'll leave it to the board's discretion in terms of whether or not you would like me to present the criteria for the conditional use permit now or later or whatever you'd like to do. But I can do that. It's in our materials as well. We can go through those criteria.
I think that would be helpful, because I believe what we should do is first rule on the conditional use permit.
Yep.
And then if that is approved,
right,
then we would go into site plan.
Okay.
May I ask a question? Mm-hmm. How are the rags disposed of? I assume they're taken off site.
They're taken to the Middleborough site for cleaning.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's a great question. I meant to mention that because I asked the same question. So, procedurally, we first would ask that you accept our application as complete, and then I'll go next to the conditional use permit if that makes sense to you.
we have completeness of application for conditional use permit?
No, just for the site plan.
I'll do the conditional use permit first.
Conditional use permit.
Okay. All right. So there's a list of criteria. There's 10 in your regulations. They're identified in our application. So the reasoning for each one of our reasons why we fulfill those requirements is also mimics the requirements itself, so you wouldn't have to jump back and forth with your your document. It's all in one spot. The first criteria is that the permit is in the public interest, and we believe that we satisfy that criteria as the use represents a reasonable use, not only for the property, but for the area in general. The facility will obviously offer the residents of Newmarket and also of the Seacoast an opportunity to use a facility where they can have these services performed, basically go direct to the crematoria. The facility will also be used by practicing veterinarians as well, who may be asked to facilitate that process on behalf of a client, as opposed to the client coming directly to the facility. The facility will certainly be in the public interest in terms of putting the property on the tax rolls. Now it sits in the hands of the town and generates nothing for the town. And we believe it would have no negative effect on either the town or the abutters. One thing that I should have mentioned, and I didn't, and I'll mention it now, is we'll need 2 permits from the state. We will need a solid waste permit because, as I explained, those regulations apply. And we'll also need a air quality permit. Those are standard things for any crematory to get. And the way that happens in this field is a little bit different. We need to basically get the approval of the site plan in order for the engineers of the company that produces these crematoria. They typically would be the ones, because they have all the data, to go to the state and show that this facility will meet all the state's requirements. And they do that all the time. So we're not concerned that, those requirements wouldn't be met. It's just they would do that. So we would suggest as a condition of approval that it be conditioned on us getting those 2 permits from the state, because that's what we need to have an approval in order to go get those. So in any event, there are appropriate mechanisms to deal with the air quality as well when they do the burn, which actually is known to be a very clean burn. In fact, that came up in the ZBA, and we provided some evidence with respect to that. The second criteria is that there will be no greater diminution of neighborhood property values than would be created under any other use permitted in the zone. The property values themselves, we presume, have the abutting properties have a value associated with what the past use of this property was, which is a DPW facility. This is a much less intensive use, the use in general, it's a B3 zone, is a business zone district. So basically what we're providing is a business to just operate in this property, and it is only called a flexible use because in your zoning ordinance, as one would expect, you came up with a lot of uses which are all typical and consistent with other zoning ordinances, but it's unique to have a crematoria, and so that's why we fall under that, and that's why we have to ask for this permit. But again, nothing would change on the outside of the building, and it would be a very low intensity use, and it would employ state-of-the-art technology. So we believe there'd be no diminution in property value with respect to this use versus any other permitted use. The third criteria is that there are no existing violations of state or federal law and/or the Newmarket zoning ordinance or regulations on the subject property. Property is currently owned by the town. We know of no existing violations either with the state, federal, Newmarket zoning ordinance. And in fact, the property itself has been in front of this board within the last year. So obviously it complies with all of your regulations on subdivision and things of that matter. Otherwise you wouldn't have approved it. Four, the character of the area shall not be adversely affected as determined by consideration of the project's effect on architecture, transportation, scale of lot coverage, scale of building size, and consistency of use in the immediate area. Our position is that the character of the area shall not be adversely affected, as the existing use, again, was the town's DPW facility, which was pretty much used on a 24-hour basis with large trucks and things of that nature. This is certainly far scaled down. Again, we're not looking to build a new building. We're taking the existing building as it is. Yes?
In terms of use, I just wanted to, what's your estimated number of visits to this building per day?
Bill, can you address that?
That's a difficult question.
What are you hoping for, I guess, what it would be typical?
Well, the way we do it at this point is we have scheduled cremations of time. It's 9:15, 11:15, 1:15, and 3:15.
Okay. So not all, okay, that's pretty minimal. I just was asking that question as,
yep,
in reference to amount of use at a DPW facility.
Right. So obviously with basically four visits to the building,
okay,
we believe it would be far less intensive.
If I could just add something. Approximate time for cremation is about 2 hours.
Okay.
One scheduled.
Okay.
Thank you.
So in number five, it says the granting of the permit will not result in undue municipal expense. Applicants shall be required to offset such expense or the permit will be denied. Again, the intensity of this use will be far less than the use of the public works operation. It will be commercial in nature and obviously will not then affect your school base or anything of that nature. The opposite, obviously, is true here, is that it will actually add to the tax rolls, getting the DPW out of the hands of the town and active as a commercial entity. And again, this is the B3 zone, so it obviously would be appropriate to do that. The sixth criteria is the proposed use will be developed in a manner consistent with the spirit and intent of the ordinance and the Newmarket master plan. Again, we believe that the use will be suitable considering the surrounding properties and will result in the encouragement of an appropriate use of the land. And again, it certainly would be far less intense than the previous use. And we believe that by promoting the reasonable use of the land, particularly in the B3 zone, being a commercial use, that would be consistent with the spirit of the zoning ordinance and the master plan, which encourage a reasonable growth and use. The seventh criteria is that the capacity of existing or planned community facilities and services, including streets or highways, will not be adversely impacted. We basically rely upon the plan to suggest that it's pretty self-evident that the community facilities and services will not really see any impact at all, and certainly far less than they ever had with the DPW. The number eight is that the following impacts resulting from The granting of the permits have been mitigated to the extent practical, noise, light, transportation, visual effects. Property is heavily buffered, offering obviously a visual and noise barrier. The transportation needs have been defined as very, very minimal, and there's no noise other than maybe the opening of the front door and closing. So it's hard for us to see that that would be an issue. 9, landscaped or other appropriate buffers of sufficient capacity and materials shall be required if deemed reasonably necessary for the welfare of neighboring properties or the town. And again, we'll rely upon the site plan to suggest that there's probably more buffering on this commercial activity site than quite a few that you've seen, or certainly that I've seen. And it's a somewhat very restricted use on a lot of land, 3 acres. And again, it's it is what it is. It's be very minimal use on that large parcel. And the final one is that all development shall have frontage on an existing or proposed Class 5 town road. This project has 376 feet of frontage on Wadley Falls Road, which is a Class 5 road. Only 150 feet are required in your regulations, so we believe that we've satisfied that criteria. And with that, I think we've demonstrated we've satisfied all the 10 criteria that you have for the conditional use permit, and we'd ask that you provide your approval with respect to that. Joe's going to talk about issues that relate to the site plan, but if you have any concerns that relate to this conditional use application, that an engineer you should be answering, by all means do that. If you have any questions of me or the applicant, feel free, and we're at your disposal.
I'm going to open this up for the public, if anyone from the public has any questions.
Yeah.
If you come to the podium, please, and we need your name and address for the record.
Yeah, we're friends of Lois Bulliers, which is directly across the street.
Your name and address, please.
My name is Edward Scanlon, and I live in Newfields on 7 Scanlon Way in Newfields, which is off of Route 87. I have held property here in Newmarket before. I had a 4-unit building on Nichols Avenue and a 10-unit building on Chapel Street. But what I'm here for is Lois Bullier, and she's concerned about smell, first of all, from the killing of these large animals. And the state geologist has told her that there's $4 to $6 million of the gravel underneath her property, which is across the street, directly across the street. It is directly across the street. We're only talking here about 3 acres of land, but at the same time, there's got to be quite a bit of value to that land because of what's underneath it. But she's also concerned about noise and the traffic that would be created. If they're only doing, 4 visits a day, there's not going to be much traffic, I'm sure, but still. The noise is one of the, and he did mention that the noise is going to be cut down as much as possible, but what about the smell of the animals before they're getting killed, being slaughtered, and, after they...
I'm not sure that they're...
We'll have the applicant answer that.
Oh, right. Okay. That's what it is.
Okay. If the applicant will just address that particular question about the smell.
You correct me if I'm wrong, but they come, the animals come and are put in a freezer so that it addresses the decay issue right away. And there's no discernible, they're transferred from one vehicle right into the building into a freezer. So that issue is addressed. And there is no smell associated with the burning. They have filters that come from a crematoria, and it generates no smell. In fact, if you were ever down in Kittery, there's actually a crematoria right in the middle of Route 1. It doesn't produce any issue there, and it's known not to have any smell associated with it. But do you want to expand on that?
It's not an abattoir.
Excuse me. I can address most of the question on the smell. First of all, when we deal with the pets, Most of the times, they come from the veterinarian. The veterinarian has to have a chest freezer, and they're put in the chest freezer in body bags and sealed. So there's no leak of any fluid. There's no smell when we pick them up. When we transport them back to our facility, we have a huge walk-in freezer, and they're put into the freezer until they're scheduled to be cremated. As far as addressing the smell, the state requires that there be no smoke and no smell coming from the stacks. And the crematory companies have to meet those regulations in order to put a unit into any state. Each state has certain requirements. They may differ a little bit, but each company that produces the crematory have their own engineers that submit all the data that comes out from the stack, and that there's certain particulates that the state looks for. No smoke and no odor. I've been doing this for 30 years, and I've never had a complaint. Did I address that?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yes?
My name's Carolyn Scanlon. That's my husband. I had some questions from, like we said, we're here specifically for Lois because she lives across the street, and she just got out of the hospital. She couldn't come herself, so that's why she asked us to come. But I was just wondering, it sounds like the paper that she got said large animals. It said large animals. So we're thinking cows, horses, llamas, you know, as large animals you get. Are these animals coming up from Massachusetts too?
No.
You know, this is all going to be New Hampshire?
Well, it could be from New Hampshire. In Massachusetts, we deal, we already have veterinary hospitals that we deal with in New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're trying to do is establish a facility here that I can base from to do the veterinarians up here in this area.
Okay. Now, what do you do with the ashes? You say you're going to take the ashes and send them back down after in containers and stuff like that. What do you do with the ashes?
Okay, there's two things. First of all, with the arrangements, the owner can have an individual cremation.
Mm-hmm.
That means the pet is put into the crematory, cremated, and then we return the ashes back to the owner.
Right.
The other situation is sometimes the owner doesn't want the ashes back. There's more than one pet that's in the crematory, and then they're cremated. Now, as we addressed this before, in Massachusetts, we have a solid waste permit that allows me to do the burial of the ashes. So we told the town this is what's going to happen. We're going to have the ashes removed to my facility in Massachusetts and then buried there.
Okay, so, I mean, you would have to wait for, you're not going to take so many, just little boxes down each day, like you're going to let it accumulate and go, what, so many trips or something?
Seven days. Right.
7 days. Okay, and, but I was just wondering, it isn't something that the town could benefit from. I mean, is the ashes used in fertilizer or in something like that, or?
That they're actually toxic.
It's kind of a sensitive subject on that, just to answer that, because these are people's pets and things.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't be right for me to do anything other than what we advertise. We bury the ashes at the facility, so I can't do that.
Yeah, okay. No, these are just questions that, you know, she was asking, so I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, right,
because she was wondering about that. Okay, I guess that's basically it. It was the noise, the smell, the lights, you know, would be affecting her, if anything like that. And you've already explained that. So. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I would, I think maybe the best way for the board to proceed through this is to go through each of the criteria for the conditional use permit. And if any members of the board have questions of the applicant relative to that particular criteria, and then we could just move this forward. Does anyone object to that?
No.
Okay, the first one, the permit is in the public interest. Does anyone have any questions or any comments relating to that? Is there a consensus? Do we feel it meets the?
Yes.
Okay, no one would object. Okay. The issue of no graded diminution of neighboring property values will be created under any other use permitted in the zone. Rick?
Do we need to have a realtor come in and make that assessment as opposed to, I don't appreciate all you've said, but I think that's something that we should look at that way.
Did you have any evidence from a professional, either an appraiser or a commercial broker?
Well, I am a commercial broker. I'm licensed in New Hampshire and Massachusetts. But I have been through a lot of these hearings, and I know that it is not a requirement that you have that kind of evidence. I think what we presented is this is the B3 zone. We have to kind of keep that in mind, that commercial activities are required, permitted. And so in the context of what is permitted, which is obviously listed in your zoning ordinance, this is basically a business of either like kind in terms of that list or even less intensity. And so in that context, we're suggesting that you can come to that conclusion that it would not diminish the property. I believe that as a broker, I guess, to be the case as well, that it would not diminish the property with respect to any other kind of business use that's permitted. So I think you can use your judgment.
Yeah, I think.
And obviously, if you needed that evidence, your regulations would require that, and they don't.
Well, the regulation is that there will be no greater diminution in neighboring property values than would be created on any other use permitted in the zone.
Right.
So, but what we don't have is any factual evidence that would show that the crematorium use, which is not a permitted use, and that it's not on a permitted use list. There's no specific factual data that's been presented that particular use would not be create a diminution of neighboring property.
Well, it's juxtaposed to the other permitted uses. So it's in that context that the question is asked. That's what the criteria says. And
let me put it
in a different context. You have conditional use permits coming in front of you all the time. I presume you've made decisions many, many times without a real estate agent coming in with a report. And I have done many variances, and one of the criteria, as you may be aware, is that the grant of the variance would not diminish the surrounding property values. And it's somewhat rare to have a broker or an appraiser come in and speak to that issue. But again, I can offer as a commercial broker that it would not result in that. But the data, the evidence that we've suggested is exactly what we want to do. I don't know what the study would be in terms of what any professional would do beyond coming in and giving you that opinion, because it would
I think it should be an independent appraiser.
Hold on. Do we have a question, Elizabeth? Or?
Yes. I just would, I mean, if we look again at table of permitted uses for B3, warehousing is permitted there. Mm-hmm. Light manufacturing is permitted there. And so is manufacturing.
Right.
So, to my mind, this is not substantially distant from any of those uses.
Yeah, and I think that's our point is when you look at the uses, particularly manufacturing, you as a board can draw from your own experience. Is a crematory, as we've described it, which again is a very low intensity use, is that when you consider it as opposed to a manufacturing use on this property, which is permitted as a matter of right, is this use likely to create more of a diminution in property value than a manufacturing facility? And that's what this question is about. And we've presented, I think, a good case that this is far less intense than either what was there or what could be there as a matter of right without the conditional use permit. And the abutters have not, there's been no abutter input to suggest otherwise at all. So we'd ask that you consider it in that context.
Anyone else would be looking to have this as a condition, I think, which is what Rick is referring to, or are people comfortable that it would not be required?
I'm comfortable with it. I think...
I'm comfortable. I think there's less offensive output than lots of manufacturing or potentially businesses could provide.
I also think that the fact that we don't have any abutters here objecting, or even people in the neighborhood, that you know, will play in. Diane?
There is a animal crematorium in the area that I visited, Whispering Pines up in Dover, which is in back of the Equine Veterinarian Clinic, right off of 6th Street, near exit 9, I believe it is. And I went to visit because Mr. Silver, who's one of the applicant's colleagues, I guess, had suggested come up to Whispering Pines and look at our facility. And I found that it was very obscure. It was way in the back. You wouldn't even know it was there. It was a nice little building. It was clean. It was kept up well. And there was no negative impacts that were visible to me. There was no odor. There was nothing that would even suggest what the use was in the building. So I just wanted to share that with you, that it was a really very benign, if you will, type use. And I didn't see that there would, you know, be any real major negative impacts associated with having that type of facility here in Newmarket.
That's adjacent to the Equine Center, the hotel, Margaritas.
That's right. That was what I was going to suggest, too. You have a hotel.
There's a wetland buffer in back, but I was very, very surprised. Well, pleasantly surprised.
Plus a very large medical facility, part of Wentworth Douglas, is right there.
Rick, are you good?
I'm fine. Okay. Thank you.
Number three, I think Diane has confirmed, correct? There's no existing violations?
No.
Okay, we'll skip over that. Number four, care to the area shall not be adversely affected as determined by consideration of the effects, project's effects on the architecture, transportation, scale of lot coverage, scale of building, consistency of uses. Any questions or issues with that? No. Okay. Granting the permit will not result in undue municipal expense. Applicants should be required to offset such expense if the permits will be denied. I think that the fact that it's coming on the tax roll is huge.
Sure.
The proposed use will be developed in a manner consistent with the spirit and intent of the ordinance and the Newmarket Master Plan. This is a B1 zone. Commercial development is what is the goal of that.
Is it B3 or B1?
Excuse me.
B3.
So any questions or comments on that one? The capacity of existing or planned community facilities and services, including streets and highways, will not be adversely impacted. Excuse me. I think we're good with that. The following impacts resulting from the granting of the permits have been mitigated to the extent practical: noise, light, transportation, visual effects.
I just have a question.
Sure.
Diane, you can probably answer this, where you've been over there. Signage.
There was no signage that I saw in Dover. Will there be signage proposed?
I mean, we want to deal with that on site plan.
How big is your...
Yeah, I mean, I know that everyone has sign regulations. We're not asking for a variance, and you have dimensional requirements for your signage. So whatever it is, we're not going to ask for a variance. So be like any other business.
The landscape or other appropriate buffers of sufficient capacity and material shall be required if deemed reasonably necessary for the welfare of neighboring properties or the town. Does anyone have any comments there? And we'll probably get more into that in site plan. And all developments shall frontage on the existing post class 5 town road. That has been met. Is there any further discussion by the board? If not, I'll entertain a motion to approve or disapprove the conditional use permit. Who's jumping in?
All right, I'll make a motion to approve the conditional use permit for the crematorium.
For a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? conditional use permit has been granted. There's a 30-day appeal on that. Let's move to site plan.
So this is the easy part for me. I'm just going to say, here's Joe, and I'm going to shut up.
Again, for the record, I'm Joe Prescino from Ty and Bond. FX has already done a pretty good job going over the site plan. It's remaining the same as it is today. The existing driveway, parking area, building, and vegetation will remain. There's no site improvements for the site at this time. Earlier in the week, Diane and I actually had a conversation, which was very helpful. We walked through the site plan requirements and items that that she had brought up and provided to you this evening. So if you'd like, I can go into those or answer any questions before I go into the questions that were listed on the planning memo.
Are you requesting any waivers?
At this point, no, we're not requesting any waivers.
Say at this point.
He said it twice. A little before. Yeah. I wrote that down and then again. So that when you
I guess,
concerned.
No, we're not requesting
there are
any
no
waivers.
Work waiver, okay. Yeah, yes. With the application. Okay. So first I'll ask Diane.
That's Ben. That's Ken. No waivers.
Comes up with something that we have to do. We don't think so.
Diane, you've done a nice checklist on the completeness of the minor review application.
Okay.
And can you just identify what is not addressed?
Well, I had a few questions, and I did review them with Mr. Prescino. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Prescino, yes. Prescino, yes. Thank
okay.
you.
And I guess I'd like to have him address some of those issues right here while we're all here. It did say on the cover sheet of the application, and it was referring to the name of the business, but it did make reference to a cemetery, and I've asked that be taken off the plan title so that it won't be any confusion on what we did approve, that we're just approving the crematorium use at this point.
Exactly. We'll change the title of the plan set to Angel View Crematory.
Okay.
And just only list the applicant and as the full name of the business.
Okay, that's fine. If we could have a little more information about the size of the building.
Yep.
I think it's roughly about 3,600 square feet. I wasn't sure the exact dimension, but that information would be helpful on the site plan.
Yep, we will definitely add that. We've added it to the color plan that we brought here tonight. It's approximately 3,200 square feet.
Okay.
It's 40 feet wide and 80 feet long. Okay. So it's rectangular.
All right. Also, you've shown an area that's currently serves as a parking area, if you will, mm-hmm. or a loading area, mm-hmm. and it'd be helpful to know the number of parking spaces and where the actual loading will be. Is there a loading bay or a loading dock, per se, that would be utilized, or is there a door? And it wasn't clear to me how that worked with the site, because the site plan was rather sketchy.
Exactly. Basically, there's no site plan improvement, so the existing parking and loading areas are, you know, both in front and behind the building. They're easily accommodate 10 parking spaces, which is greater than the number of employees by twice using the building, and then would be room for visitors as well. And as far as loading goes, animals are delivered to the site in a commercial van-sized vehicle, so there's no loading dock or anything of that sort. They'd just be accessing
What I want to do is pass around a picture because
sure.
there's a
okay.
kind of a garage opening that already exists.
Okay. So that'd be helpful. Thank you. There was also all of our projects are required to be in compliance with the Americans with Disability Act, and the question that I had was whether or not there would be any public use. And I think Mr. Bruton had mentioned that there would be, on occasion, visitors who would come to the site, and they would there possibly be a few family members. And given that, there would have to be the facility would have to be ADA accessible. And I wanted to have you respond to that because I'm not that familiar with the site and whether or not it is.
Sure. You know, there will be some slight modifications to the interior of the building. Obviously, code compliance is part of those modifications. You know, Bill will have to meet with the code enforcement officer, review the modifications he makes to the interior of the building and address any ADA compliance issues, you know, as part of that construction process or modification process of the building. The exterior of the site is virtually dead flat. It meets all the ADA cross slopes and slopes to the building, so that's not an issue. It's ADA compliant kind of as is from a grading standpoint.
Okay. And the last question has to do with the septic system that's there. It seems like the information is very sketchy on what's
yes.
there.
Yes, yeah, I appreciate
how large
that.
How large it is and whether it's designed to accommodate this type of use.
Exactly, yes. That's a great description, actually. Diane, thanks for bringing that up, because from all the research that's been done, there is no plan that exists that shows the exact design and layout of the septic system, nor can we find at the state level that that plan. So this is a, you know, town-owned DPW building for many years. They've had a use of toilet facilities at the building, hand washing facilities at the building. There is a what appears to be a septic tank out there, and location of the approximate location of the leach field is on the back side of the building. Basically, you can tell which way pipes are going. So we know that there is a septic system out there. We know that it functions, or at least did at the last point that they were using it, and there's been no reason to believe that it has not or ceased to function since that time. We basically worked backwards from a minimum design that you would complete for the state, which is 300 gallons per day, which is a pretty low number for any use. But that's the minimum that the state requires, 300 gallons per day. Two bedrooms is approximately equivalent. With approximately five employees using the building plus visitors, you come up to about 100 gallons per day in use at 20 gallons per day per person. So that being said, we're still far below what a minimum design would be. So we're comfortable with the fact that moving in, using the building, using the existing septic system that's been in use for years, would still function under the low demand for this use. Again, there's really no other use besides hand washing and maybe the occasional water closet use, so to speak. So that's what we have to share as far as the existing septic system goes.
We're not going to get into discussion yet because we haven't even separated the application. I'm just trying to get Diane to get through whether or not we have a complete application.
Yep.
I see you've made some modifications to the site plan, so it's a little bit clearer where the buffer areas are and the layout of the driveway and the positioning of the building with respect to the septic system.
Yep.
So it appears that you've clarified some of the questions that I had on the site
yep.
layout. There is a requirement that all applications be presented to our police chief, fire chief, and public works director for their input. And I don't see that that happened as part of the application process. So I would suggest on condition on the acceptance of the application that the application be forwarded to them and that they be given the opportunity to comment on the application and provide their recommendations and that they be considered by the planning board as part of any final approval.
Diane, would that be covered in terms of your sending it to your TRC? Is that the
function? Well, that typically the applicant does that as okay. part of the application process.
Okay. So you would like us to forward it to all those department heads?
That would be helpful.
Okay, we'll
with
do
a set
that
of
tomorrow.
Plans.
Okay.
Did they provide the necessary 8 or 10 sets?
Yes.
Okay.
We have three large sets okay. and the smaller sets.
Okay, at this point I'll entertain a motion to accept the application is substantially complete.
Can I ask you a question about that?
About the application?
Yes. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that it's important to know where a septic is for anyone to move in. And I was just thinking that the DPW could be asked to identify it since they were there.
Well, let's the deal with that in the review of the site plan. This is whether or not the actual application is substantially complete. It doesn't have to be totally complete.
Oh, substantially complete. Okay. Then
the planner has deemed it as being substantially complete.
which...
That's why it's on the agenda.
...is the basis for acceptance of the application for review.
I'd just like to entertain a motion that to accept this, their application as being substantially complete.
Make a motion to accept the application of site, for site, as partially complete of the requested by the town of Newmarket / William Morgan - Angel View Pet Cemetery and Crematory at 426 Wadley Falls Road, tax map 6, R6, lot 52-1, B3 zone, with any conditions.
But don't we have to call it substantially complete?
Substantially.
Substantially. Is there a second?
Right there.
Is there a second to Rick's motion to accept the application? Thank you, Jane. All those in favor?
Aye.
Right. Okay, the application is before us. The clock is ticking. So I think the next part about this is to, we should move this to TRC. Are there any questions that the board will have of the applicant or TR or the technical review committee on review?
Well, can I just bring up again my idea for asking the former residents, DPW, to provide information to the applicant since they use that property and since they're DPW people probably know about the septic?
I would recommend that the applicant have to provide a full septic inspection of the existing septic. That will determine what is there, where it exactly is, by a qualified septic inspector.
Okay.
It will determine the size, the condition. I mean, that would be my recommendation to TRC, to request in, or as a condition of approval.
And we'd be more than happy to meet with the DPW and walk the site again as part of the...
I just don't think it gives us any qualified answer to what is existing today in the operational condition of that.
I think that's important. It given its proximity to the aquifer, that's why I'm focusing on this.
Absolutely. Do you have a sidewalk?
Yeah, we could.
Cool. Do you want to deal with this as a TRC or as a full board? Diane, has this gone to an end?
I'd like to get some input from the Public Works Department and also from the Fire Department for any life safety issues.
So we want it to go TRC.
Yeah, but I do think a site walk would be beneficial for all parties. So if you wanted to schedule something in the next couple of weeks before the TRC meets or include them in the process, that would be helpful.
That would be. Okay. Are there any other questions, though, relative to initial questions about the site plan as presented? So I'll schedule a site walk. But you want to get the TRC in before then, too. Good.
We're going to have our workshop on the 28th.
I was hoping to, so that would be good. 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
Okay. I'd like a motion to continue this the hearing until August 28th for a site walk at the Wadley Falls or Route 152.
So moved.
Before we make the motion, can I ask, in terms of the site walk, what specific factors we'll be examining or looking at so that the applicant understands why we're having a site walk?
It's for the board to have an opportunity to actually see this physical site, what's there existing, and what is being proposed, you know, on the site plan.
Just in a general way.
Well, you can see on site where the buffers are that they're describing here, all of the items that are located on the site plan. 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
On the 28th. 6 p.m.
Either way works for me. I live right down the road. So.
I prefer.
Okay. I'm sorry. Rick, you made that motion. Is there a second?
I second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Diane, and then Rick, you'll coordinate TRC with Diane?
Yes, I will.
Okay, thanks.
Do we have anybody else with the TRC committee, by the way?
Does that mean you're volunteering?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. We're good?
We're good.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next order of business?
Thank you.
You're welcome, thank you.
Thank you, Joan.
Two items that I'll report on.
Yes, to the next meeting.
I'll give it to him.
Would we do that at the site walk?
No, as part of this meeting, you'd want to do that to.
So Rick, okay, can you have another motion to continue the hearing for site plan?
I think the meeting in September is the 14th instead of the 11th because of the primary. I'm sorry, the 18th.
Okay.
So I'm going to continue to.
Continue the hearing.
Is that the 18th, you said?
Till the 18th.
Thank you.
Thank you.
To the 18th.
Is there a second? Jane, all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Don't tell Janice that. Okay. Okay, I'm just going to report on two items. We've had some discussions with the B1 rezoning subcommittee, and what we'd like to do is move forward to the town council all the changes at once, not just the proposed ordinance changes for the Elm Street location. And so we'd like to deal with all of the Route 108 from the town line to the car wash. And what we're what the consideration there would be to propose that whole B1 get changed to M2. And it does fall under the downtown overlay district, which is critical because that deals with any multifamily use in that area would require commercial use on the first floor. I would like to have another workshop meeting on the 28th, and that we could. Does that give us enough time for notice?
Of August, I think she wants to piggyback.
We'll delay that till September because we need to. I want to notify the owners in that district and the butters, like we did on Elm Street. Okay, so we'll have that on the we'll probably try to just fit it in on the 18th of September. Okay. And then the second issue people may be aware of is at the town council meeting tomorrow night is a proposed land use for a wastewater and refuse to energy plant proposal that's coming before the council with the town owning a percentage of the business. I'm only bringing this forward because it's my understanding that the town is exempt from the ordinances. Is that correct?
Exempt from the zoning ordinance, perhaps, but not the site review ordinance.
All of them?
With the clarification from legal counsel.
Okay.
What ordinance are you?
Any site plan or my understanding is that the town.
If it's town-owned land.
Right.
The town could be exempt from zoning.
From zoning.
But if it's.
Any zone.
But there's certain types of uses that are preempted by the local zoning. Mm-hmm. Which I would think a waste energy plant, which is what I've been heard, is a solid waste facility, which would come under the jurisdiction of the state.
So I'm not sure about that. The only question I think that I want to move forward from a planning board perspective is whether or not a proposed business on a town-owned property or that the town is in partnership with, does that have to come before the planning board? Okay, I think that would be good to get a legal determination of that.
Great. Does it matter the magnitude of the town ownership? 1%, 10%, 50%, does that matter?
I think it just needs to go to council to say what.
Okay. Does the Shoreland Overland Protection District apply to this site?
No, it's a general question whether it's this site or any site.
Wouldn't that take preeminence over?
the town land being exempt from ordinance?
This is dealing specifically with ordinances and with site plan review of any business.
But I guess my question is, doesn't the Shoreland Overland Protection Act trump any town?
The more restrictive.
Right, right. So I would think that.
This property is not in the Shoreland.
Oh, it isn't. That's what my question is.
So.
I don't believe it is.
Well, I think that's an interesting question to look at.
Are we talking about the Wilson firm? I don't know what the property is.
We have the same ordinance, so it's, our Shoreland ordinance is the state ordinance.
But if we are exempt from our ordinances, maybe we're not exempt from state ordinances, my point.
Yeah, but from a planning board perspective, I think what we want to know is, does a project that comes before the, does a project that comes before the town council, which is on town-owned land, or that the town is a partner in, does that have to come before the planning board?
I would think it should, as a matter of principle.
So I think that I just want to pass that along that.
There you go.
I like the way you said that.
Well, we have a.
As a planning board rep.
Well, we can, you know, we're not, you know.
We would have that question. We would have that question.
If it doesn't, I would maybe make a motion to suggest that it's important for the future of this town more than just, I would say that town, what happens on town land is just as important for the citizens of this town as what happens on non-town land, so it doesn't, seems illogical to me to have the town not have to be examining its own actions.
The reason for the question. So Ed, if you would pass that forward, that, and if the board concurs that we would like to get a legal opinion on that, have Diane follow up on that?
Or couldn't the board simply ask that we would like to?
We need a legal opinion.
We're going to need a legal opinion.
I think we need a legal opinion, but.
Diane, I think you should probably talk to Chairman Nazaro.
I would be happy to.
Or share that legal opinion with him. But Ed, if you would, when you do your planning board report to the council, if you could just mention that that was raised.
Correct.
The other part of that, with the proposal being on, as I understand it, on what we would have referred to as the, I'm going to call it the north corridor, the southern corridor of the business district. We're right in the middle of the, or we're just starting our land use planning chapter and our future land use chapter. And then they're also just starting to move forward with our Chapter 6 economic development implementation. That relative to timing, that it would be really good to get a better handle from a planning perspective on where we're looking for the town to go in these various areas of undeveloped property, which primarily are going to be the 152 in the southern corridor. And that is just starting. I know that Chairman Nazaro has, or that the town council has formulated the Economic Development Committee. And I'm going to appoint myself to be the planning board appointee to that. So those are just kind of two questions relative to a business proposal coming before the town council that the planning board would like to provide some input on. That is my chairman's report, other than there is the Municipal Volunteer of the Year Awards is accepting nominations that need to be submitted to the LGC by August 31st. So there's, you can go to the NewHampshireLGC.org to get information about that. And they're basically looking if anyone wants to nominate a Shining Star from Municipal Volunteer of the Year Award, and anyone can do this. There'll be a brief questionnaire. We'll ask the person who's doing the nomination to describe how the person they're nominating contributes to the community, demonstrates leadership, inspires others to participate, and applies new or innovative approaches. They would need additional information such as annual hours and years of volunteer service they've provided to the town. And then the nomination has to be approved from the chair of the board of the city council. Okay. And that's all I have. Anything from the town council to report that we should be aware of, Ed?
Yes, at our last meeting on, I think it was August 1st, we elected two councilors to the Economic Development Committee, and they were Councilman Nazaro and Councilman Levy. Also, let's see, Diane Hardy was nominated to Stratford Metropolitan Planning Organization, Transportation Planning for the Region. And
thank you.
Yep.
Thank you, Ed. Jean?
Yes?
Anything on, what do we got you on? CIP?
Yes, CIP, working with Rick. We have a meeting on Thursday to the police station, right?
Right.
And we'll hear their position.
Right.
With the tour.
We met already with the water and sewer.
Right.
And we had to cancel the library because they didn't get their thing in on time. And so we should be through about August 22nd or something like that. It's relatively early because there's not many requests going in other than the major ones.
September 22nd.
September 22nd, okay. I'm sorry. So it's moving forward. We got a good committee. A lot of input.
Great. Elizabeth, anything on advisory heritage?
We've meeting scheduled on the 23rd.
Of August?
Yes.
On?
Just a general meeting.
Okay. Just a general meeting? Okay. Diane, anything on from the planner? Any updates or...
Just that we received an update from Tim Nichols. He's still working on his project at 13 Water Street. He's hired a historic preservation consultant who's looking at the eligibility of the building for the National Register of Historic Places and whether or not it's eligible for 79E application. And as part of that process, they're now looking at the possibility of rehabilitating the building as opposed
to reconstructing.
Reconstructing it and building anew. And he's hoping to get some information to us on that. So we haven't received revised plans yet, but we're holding out to see how he fares in that process. He may come to the Advisory Heritage Commission with an application seeking input from you, Elizabeth, your group, and that will be considered by the town council as part of their review of the 79E application that has come before the town.
But to
in veins right now.
To my mind, the volume of the building is not comparable in any way to what he was proposing, so I'm curious to know if he has a shift in intended use.
I have no idea. We just got a two-bullet update tonight.
Interesting.
But he is still working on the application, and as soon as we have revised plans, we'll call a technical review committee meeting and move forward with the review of the plans. Okay, that's all I have, Chairman.
Okay, any other new or old business?
Do you want me to make the motion now?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes, there's definitely some new old business.
Yes.
We need to fill the remaining term for Peter Roy's resignation, which is through the 2013?
Yes.
Okay.
I'd like to make a motion that we appoint Representative Adam Schroeder to the position with term to extend to March of 2013.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Wise decision.
I may be short, but I'm not dumb.
Any discussion on the motion? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries. Adam, we'll look forward to having you back here, on the site walk. And next September, the meeting. Okay, any further old or new business? Thank you, Rick. Motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All's in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.